Everybody, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed, the television edition. It is February 21st, 2017. Oh, it's almost spring, because in my mind, March 1st is the first day of spring. And we have with us, staying over from John Hopwood's show. If you missed Ward 13 with John Hopwood, of course, we'll have it up on YouTube tomorrow, as well as this show. But we have Heather Ouellette-Sagan. Is it Ouellette or Ouellette?
Ouellette.
Ouellette, okay. And her son Cameron is here as well. How are you, sir?
Good.
Or Sparky,
yes.
As John called you. All right, no. Why does John call you Sparky? Because that totally was out of left field to me.
I was given the nickname Sparky a few years ago by our good friend Ryan, who's also part of GLSEN. He was a former co-chair before I took his place. I can be a little bit on the energetic side, so
okay.
He just kind of dubbed Sparky as like my call sign. Or
Very good.
Yeah.
So you both are from GLSEN.
Yes.
Which is GLSEN, is
yes.
That right? Okay. So what is GLSEN? We'll start there.
GLSEN stood for the Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network, but it's kind of stretching out to just being one of the leading organizations in the country to help with school safety, anti-bullying, mm-hmm. While still specializing in LGBT protections, but...
Yeah.
Kind of spreading around to all students, really.
Yeah. So you both work with the New Hampshire chapter?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And for how long?
Since we took the reins in 2010.
Oh,
There was a GLSEN Southwest chapter that was located over in the Keene, Monadnock area, and it was down to about three women who were running things and very tired and ready to move on, and so... We connected. Oh, Cameron and I went to Washington, D.C. We applied for and were accepted to a Safe Schools Advocacy Summit in Washington, D.C. with GLSEN. So they do policy work there. And when these women learned that we had done that, they planned this meeting and then said, yeah, we're done. Here you go.
Yeah,
and
we kind of took it over from there.
Since the start.
So are they not involved? Like, did they literally just kind of push it on you and then leave? Like, are they not involved at all anymore?
they've been there, here and out, yeah. Mentors
Bobby,
at the beginning.
Bobby Berry, who, well, actually, she's recently moved to Maine, but she was very involved with PFLAG, which is the formerly known as Parents, Family, Friends of Lesbians and Gays, which is a family-focused group that helps families. With gay relatives. She was still the head of PFLAG New Hampshire for a while and still connected with us, but she's kind of stepped away too, so.
Yeah. So do you have other, I mean, are there other members of the organization who work as volunteers? Or?
Yeah. So we have a board of about 12, and then we have volunteers, and we're really, we actually, because of things politically right now, we've had quite a number of folks reaching out to us and wanting to volunteer and help in ways that they can. So we're trying to work on ways to best utilize people's skills and talents to help us.
And this is on top of your day job, of course, because you're an educator.
Yeah.
You teach in Manchester?
I teach at Concord High School.
Oh, okay. Yep. Very good, very good. I graduated from there a long time ago, and it's, of course, now if I drive by it, it's like three times the size that it was.
Yeah, they had a big renovation.
Yeah, absolutely. Talk to me a little bit about what are the issues in terms of bullying and whatnot, and I'm particularly interested in this because, you know, I had commented on John's show that my perception has always been that all of this, any kind of bigotry, whether it's in terms of sexual orientation or racial bigotry and whatnot, I think it gets better with every generation, mm-hmm. but it's also obvious that these issues are being talked about more in the media and whatnot. This is all being focused on more. We've seen a lot more talk about transgender issues in the last few years. So that's really come to the forefront. But what is, if you can kind of give us an idea, like what kind of bullying goes on and what are some of the things that you're actively fighting against with this organization?
So every year, well, every 2 years, GLSEN conducts a safe school, what do they call it?
The
Safe
Schools. National School Climate Survey.
School Climate Survey, yes. Oh, my gosh. It's been a long day. Yes, and so the latest data is from 2015, and it certainly does show that things are getting better.
Good.
In schools.
That's good
to hear. So that the things, some of the questions that they look at, it's the survey is completed by students in 6th through 12th grade in schools who identify as LGBT. Mm-hmm. And so it's everything from language, like people saying that's so gay, mm-hmm. To mean something's bad, which
right.
is very upsetting if you're a gay person,
right,
you know,
right.
To more targeted, you know, use of a more disparaging terms directed at a person. So that mm-hmm. might be a next level. To students being, you know, physically assaulted would be the worst.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so in all those areas, things have been getting better.
Good.
And what the research also shows is that there's a correlation between a school that has a GSA, a Gay Straight Alliance, mm-hmm. That students there feel safer, schools that have adults that are supportive, teachers and administration, schools that have inclusive curriculum is also big. So, you know, students, LGBT students, see themselves in the curriculum, whether it's in history or literature mm-hmm. and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So those all have correlations on them, not on those LGBT students feeling better about themselves, but also on the climate in the school and the way other students treat them.
This will sound like an odd question, but have either of you seen the movie 21 Jump Street?
No.
I actually have only seen bits and pieces.
Okay. The reason I ask is, so, I mean, you remember the show.
Yes.
And
yep.
Cameron, you probably don't. Or maybe you've seen it on Nick at Night or something, but... So I actually never saw the show, but that was Johnny Depp's first foray into mainstream entertainment. But the movie, it's a comedy version of the show, and the two main characters, Jonah Hill and I forget the other actor, they're adults now, but they can still pass for young. They're cops, and they go undercover back to high school. And the guy who's not Jonah Hill, the other guy, it's kind of a running joke in the film where he's expecting, because he was a jock in high school, and he's expecting to be cool because he's a jock, and he kind of pushes people around who aren't like him and whatnot, and, you know, there's the token gay kid who, you know, he can't, it's changed from when he was in school, and he's like telling his friend, oh, this is BS, because he can't understand why the kids who are different aren't being picked on, because it's all different now. Everybody's more sensitive. Everybody's more socially aware than when he was in school, when he was just a cool jock who, you know, if you were gay or whatever, you weren't cool. You were on the outs. Whereas now, it's kind of like it's very inclusive, and it's just and so. I was reminded of that when we were talking about how, you know, how it gets better or mm-hmm. does it get better. What about okay so. So it sounds like there's progress in the schools, but it also sounds like there's a lot that you're doing and having to fight against legislatively or mm-hmm. having to fight for in some instances. So what is happening there? Which is kind of a broad question, I know, because it seems like there's a lot. There's a lot that goes on.
There's a lot going on.
Yeah.
So GLSEN, our policy people are paying very close attention to, I guess we've shifted from, you know, 8 years of great progress for LGBT students and LGBT folks of all ages to now, instead of, you know, well, maybe we're not going to make progress, but we have to really fight not to lose what we have gained.
Yeah. Actually, Heather, not to interrupt, but we do have a call, so we will take this. Hello, welcome to Unleashed. Who's on the line?
Yeah, hi, man. How you doing?
Hi, good. It's a familiar voice.
Yeah, I just want to say, Tommy, I'm an older gay person. I just want to thank your guests for being on the show. It's very interesting what you guys are talking about.
Oh, very good.
Well,
I'm sure they appreciate the support. Thank you very much. Well, that's great. Yeah. All right. So you were saying?
Yeah, I lost my train of thought. Oh, yeah. So we've really had to, I guess, now we're just positioning ourselves, seeing what's happening. Today we got an email from Eliza Byard, who's the director of GLSEN, just about, you know, this pending rollback of protections for transgender students under Title IX mm-hmm. And how we're going to be able to support things on the ground level, you know, if the federal protections go away. Because states have been trying to do that all along. So if they
yeah.
go, if the federal, so there are lawsuits in different states where people are kind of, well, not kind of, they are fighting against these policies that protect transgender children in schools. Mm-hmm. And so now we'll be reaching out to schools and seeing what we can do to help them there. Because most schools want to do the right thing.
Of course.
But they just feel that they're not educated on how best to support transgender students right now.
Which luckily we've had a lot of outreach since the election for that kind of support, those kind of trainings. So
yeah.
We're hoping to go perform some trainings and yeah. get educators yeah. kind of up to date on everything.
One yeah. of the things that GLSEN does as part of our mission is to train educators on LGBT issues. So everything from language, terms, you know, we talked on John's show about words like cisgender that we use often, you know, mm-hmm. but that most people don't use and don't necessarily understand.
Yeah.
Ways that they can best support students in the classroom and combat bullying and things like that. So training educators is a big part of our mission.
When we talk about the concern about rolling back protections, when you say protections, because I think for a lot of people, including myself, I'm no expert on this. What do you mean exactly? What are these protections that exist? What do they do?
Okay, so it would be, you know, everybody, we'll start with the bathroom thing because yeah. for some reason everybody gets all weird about the bathroom.
yeah.
But allowing a transgender student to use the bathroom that he or she feels the most comfortable in. And mm-hmm. so, you know, if it's a student that identifies and presents himself as a male student, you know, use the boys' bathroom at school, or mm-hmm. having gender-neutral bathrooms. So just last year at Concord High School, we added 2 all-gender restrooms at our school.
Huh.
So that was really nice, and it really meant a lot to students. I had a transgender student, and she just was so happy, and that she, you know, because before that she would either have to go all the way to the nurse's office or because she didn't feel comfortable going into the girls' room.
Yeah.
And so she used the all-gender restroom and
yeah.
made a big deal. So, but it's also things like using the correct pronouns for a student,
mm-hmm.
Using their name. So mm-hmm. Sometimes their name isn't changed in the system yet. They might still have the name they were given at birth, but as teachers and administrators, being respectful of their pronouns and their names mm-hmm. as well.
How many, I mean, do you know how many transgender students there are now, right now, at the school that you teach at?
We have quite a few transgender students.
Because I think yeah. the last time you were on the show, you mentioned, I don't remember what the number was, but I seem to recall, or last time you were on John's show, I should say, you said a number that surprised me, where I was just like, wow, that's much more than I would have expected.
Yeah, I think Concord High School is a pretty welcoming and accepting place. So I
yeah.
think we have a lot of students who are just transgender and nobody really gives them any grief about it.
Yeah,
so,
that's good. Yeah. That's really good.
Yeah, it's very nice.
I wonder if a lot of that just has to do with the community, because, you know, it's funny, maybe I'm just looking at it through rose-colored glasses, but it seems like when I was there, which obviously was a long time ago, but even when I went to Concord High School, I feel like, well, let me put it this way. I hear horror stories about things that happened, you know, at other schools to people from my generation, and I think, yeah, I never saw anything like that at Concord High.
Yeah.
We were better than that somehow.
That's good.
Yeah, some schools are definitely more progressive than others.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, no doubt.
Yeah,
no
so
doubt.
Cameron went to school in Belmont and had, I mean, you had a pretty...
Belmont wasn't bad. I mean, there was always those kids who just couldn't help themselves but do something stupid. But
right.
No, Belmont wasn't bad.
Yeah.
And I think it's still... Yeah. My sister is still there as a senior, and
yeah.
I think
yeah.
they're having a great time.
Yeah, good. Her best friend was transgender, and she was allowed and given permission by the administration to use the girls' room, and nobody cared.
Right.
Nobody, I don't think anybody in town, maybe they didn't know, but they
right.
But nobody really cared. Cameron took his, his boyfriend to the prom, and it was fine.
Yeah, my senior trip, they didn't make me room with the other guys because I felt uncomfortable. I got to room with all my female friends because it wasn't a big deal.
Right, right. Yeah, yeah. Interesting. Yeah, it's interesting how different schools and different communities will deal with it. And, you know, we kind of talked to on John's show a little bit about how obviously there's some parts of the country that will be not as good on this. Are there, we talked too about, obviously there's not a chapter in every state for Glisten. There's, but most of them, right? 38, I think you said?
Yeah, 36, 38, somewhere.
I think it's nearing 40, because there's a couple new ones.
Good.
But some states have multiple chapters in them because they're larger states.
Yeah, yeah. Is there, I mean, this is subjective, but is there a particular state that you think, and obviously you focus on New Hampshire, but, I mean, do you know of a particular state where they're sort of the best on these issues, where...
Our friends at Nashville.
Nashville
and Baltimore as well. Like,
they
have very strong chapters and do a lot of work. And they have, you know, especially in Nashville. Well, now Glisten Nashville has become Glisten Tennessee. So they used to have two chapters in Nashville, in Tennessee, but now they just have the one. And they do a lot of work down there. And obviously in a much tougher climate than we have in New Hampshire. So they are constantly fighting legislation that, you know, prevents teachers from being able to say anything positive about being gay at all. You know, so what is it called? Don't say gay laws or whatever. And
Baltimore's had a lot of great success too, and they've had the intersectionality facing them as well, since there's a large African-American community in Baltimore as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I know they've had a lot of success with what they're doing.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. That's good.
So they're the ones, they're the ones to beat.
yeah. So what about specifically in New Hampshire? What, you mentioned the bathroom bill before. That comes up every year, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what is it that they're trying to pass exactly?
I think what they're trying to pass this time are protections for LGBT people to make sure that, you know, you can... I don't know. I haven't read the bill. I'm going to be honest.
Yeah.
But I know that it is providing protections and ensuring that if things go away at the federal level, that this at the state will do the right thing and protect students and adults also.
Mm-hmm. At the federal level, what do we have currently? I mean, what kind of protections are we talking about federally that exist?
So under the Title IX. Under the Obama administration, that was protecting a student's right to use the locker room or the restroom that he or she felt most comfortable with. It also protected them with sports and being on sports teams.
Is that part of the executive order that he signed on that, or is this actual legislation, or you know?
I think that I don't know who...
Yeah.
Determined, but that transgender students were protected under Title IX as well.
Okay.
And so the protections that it offers for women and the equal access that it offers to women, it also offers to transgender.
Okay. Folks. Because I know there was something he had signed kind of on his way out the door, so to speak, toward the end, but I'm not clear on what exactly that was. But I know that, a lot of conservatives were mad at him about it. Of course, they're always mad at him about everything. But
doesn't matter what.
Right. Right. So, how are you both feeling about? I mean, do you think that that Trump has? Because I don't hear him say anything specifically homophobic, and like we were talking on John's show, you know, it seems like. You know, that's the one group he didn't go out of his way to offend during the campaign.
Mm-hmm.
But you also talked about some concerns anyway, I guess having to do with the people he surrounds himself with. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are the concerns and how severe are the concerns? How worried are you?
Like I was mentioning before, it feels like a horror show because everyone who is around him is very, very anti-LGBT.
Well, except for his daughter.
Well, that's true. Ivanka
she has a lot
not
of
so much.
You let her sit at the desk. So.
You know, right.
Pence is known for signing the Indiana discrimination stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Betsy DeVos has no experience in anything, actually, but she's been known to donate to anti-LGBT stuff, and she's going to be the Secretary of Education, so that's absolutely terrifying. And I think it's terrifying to know that Trump he doesn't care enough really about anything, but that's what's scary, is that he doesn't care either way. So whoever's going to push him one way or the other, he's just going to go with it.
The big fear right now is that they're going to try to pass at the federal level what they call a religious freedom bill.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, a wedding cake bill, a part of that. And so it allows people to discriminate against others based on their religious beliefs. Mm-hmm. So Cameron could, you know, go into a baker and to get a wedding cake for his wedding, and they could say, oh, no, you're gay. I'm not going to make your cake, or I'm not going to take photographs at your wedding. Which is, you know, very dehumanizing. And
I mean, I think it extends beyond that a lot of people don't think about. It could be as far as I could go to the grocery store just to get groceries, and if this grocery store manager person, whoever's in charge, doesn't want to sell me groceries.
And even scarier than that is the idea that it could affect health care as well.
Right.
So that a person could refuse to give medical treatment to a person who was LGBT.
Right. Although I would argue, in terms of a wedding cake, if you go to a baker and they don't want to make you a cake for a gay wedding, you probably don't want a cake from them anyway.
No.
As a general rule, you don't want any sort of food item created by someone who hates you. So.
Yeah. But to have them, you know.
Kind of put them through the ringer and realize that's not okay.
To protect their bigotry, to have a law to protect that bigotry, I guess, is the problem. And, you know, I mean, it's silly. I mean, if you're making wedding cakes, why wouldn't you want the gay wedding business?
Right? Well, you should want any business.
Yeah, exactly. Why would you turn away any business if you're a photographer or whatever? You know, you would think you'd want that business. But.
Yeah. But again, and this is where... This is where I might disagree just a little bit, only because it seems to me if you go to a photographer who doesn't want to take pictures at your wedding, well, do you want someone taking pictures? Do you want that person taking pictures at your wedding anyway? They're not going to do a particularly good job. So I think maybe in some instances, in terms of participating directly in your wedding, better to let the free market decide. Because I've seen things happen where someone will be publicly shamed for not wanting to bake that cake or not wanting to take those pictures, and then, you know, instead of suing them. Because I'm not particularly comfortable with, to be honest with you, when I see these instances where the gay couple then sues the... and I know it doesn't happen very often, because I've noticed people use the same examples over and over again, like the cake maker in Oklahoma. Well, the reason they keep using those same examples over and over is because there aren't very many examples to use where this specific thing happens, but where the cake maker in Oklahoma ends up losing his or her business because they've been sued into submission by the gay couple. But I think the best way to attack that is use social media and say, look, we went to this cake maker, and because they think that being homophobic is going to get them into heaven, they don't want to make our cake. Isn't that silly? And then and use the pressure of the free market, because the thing is, I think in the macro, you have more success doing it that way anyway, because it's very difficult for even the most conservative religious person, you know, because they tend to be very Republican, they tend to be very pro-free market. So it's difficult for them to then argue against you if you're using the market forces to kind of take down that cake maker, because, well, these people tend to be very pro-free market anyway. So all you're doing is using the free market against them. So that's my feeling about it. But again, like I said too, it doesn't happen very often that someone is sued out of their business. But I forget what exactly it was that Pence did in Indiana, what that bill said, because there was one bill, and then he tried to. Didn't he try to change it to kind of take some of the teeth out of it, and then eventually just gave up? Is that what happened?
Yeah, it was one of those discriminatory bills, the religious freedom, I think it was. And it had all the inclusive language, so sexual orientation, gender identity expression. And as soon as he signed that, it was passed. That's when the teeth came out.
Okay.
And he got attacked for it. And I believe what happened was he went back and he took out some of that language.
Right.
I can't remember exactly what was taken out, but it was to kind of not be so specific about it.
Well, if I remember this right...
That was an example of the free market being used against and enforcing him to roll back, because businesses started pulling out. Well, we're not going to have our convention there.
Yep. I think that's the
and
way
to
do it.
And it's also happened in North Carolina as well because of their bathroom bill.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, Springsteen canceled a concert there. And
quite a few bands did, actually. They lost a lot of revenue.
Sporting events were canceled.
Yeah, yeah. That's the way to attack it, because then these conservatives can't say, well, that's not fair. What's not fair about it?
Yeah.
You're using free market capitalism. That's people vote with their dollar. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If I, and my memory of it isn't clear, but I think what happened, this is how I remember it, when Pence changed the bill, he changed it so much that it was like, well, now why even bother? Because he changed it to the point where it's like, well, this doesn't even mean anything, you know. But he's still trying to appease,
mm-hmm.
you know, these people. But yeah, but I do wish, you know, as a society, as a culture, we could just get past all of it. It's you know what I mean.
It's
just,
time.
It is. Yeah. It's like my uncle always says. You know, it's a big world. There's room for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know. But I do think it gets better. Now here in New Hampshire, is there anything other than this bathroom bill that keeps coming up, or did that ever pass the one that the conservatives were pushing?
No,
they never did. Okay. No. But is there anything else that they have presented that you've had to fight against in this state?
Well, we had to fight. I mean, this was a few years ago, but New Hampshire has a decent anti-bullying law.
Okay.
And it does include enumerated language in the, not actually in the law itself, but in the, now I can't remember what it's called, not the preamble, but the kind of introduction to the law that includes LGBT students. It includes race and gender, and so it includes categories of students who are most often bullied. So it could be, you know, because of your body type or your disability, all of those things. And so it does include LGBT inclusive language. A year after it was passed, we had to go and speak because there were people trying to roll back parts of it and take out some of the protections that it was offering for New Hampshire students.
Well, what, so in terms of protections, I mean, what are the protections?
So if a student is being, it defines very clearly, you know, what bullying is or harassment, and then it gives very specific things that schools have to do, steps that schools have to take. They have to address it. They have to follow certain steps. They have to, you know, do everything in their power to make it stop.
Right.
And then parents have legal recourse if the school's not doing what they need to do to stop the bullying.
Another side of that battle we had to face, though, is a lot of teachers are faced about accidentally outing a student to their parents. I can't remember what...
So there is usually part of protecting a child is letting the parents know, you know, this is happening, we're intervening. However, sometimes that will inadvertently out. So there is a protection in our law that if it is a student who's being bullied for being gay and they're not out at home, then they don't have to call the parents.
Where that all gets complicated.
Yes.
Yeah. Interesting. So what happens? So if a school doesn't do what they're supposed to do, what happens then? Or does that ever happen? Or does everyone, maybe everyone follows the law?
I think most schools are trying to do their best to protect kids. I think also at a lot of schools right now, most of the bullying is not the traditional stuff that happened when we were in school. It's mm-hmm. cyberbullying.
Yeah.
And so they're spending, I know administrators at my school spend a lot of their time tracking that down and protecting kids who are being cyberbullied.
Right. You know, the difficult thing is, too, with bullying in schools is it can be, it's a little like prison in the sense mm-hmm. that, you know, like in prison, what are you going to do, go to the warden? You know, you're just going to get... you know, it's just going to get worse. And I mean, from what I remember in school, I mean, I was never bullied, but I saw, you know, a little bit of it. And it's like, if you go tell somebody, then that can really come back to bite you. So it's very, very, very difficult.
Yeah, and it's terrible.
And I would guess that part of what's good and obviously there's a few things that are good about this, but I would guess part of what's good about having these protections in place is it somewhat, I would think, takes the onus off of the student to have to figure out what to do, mm-hmm. because there's already an apparatus there. There's already a system for teachers and the administration to follow. So it's not, so it's less like the student is having to go and say, will you please help me? Because they're legally, or you're an educator, you're legally required to help.
Yep. Yeah, I think that's exactly true. And there's a protocol for teachers and administrators to go through to, mm-hmm. to do everything they can to make it stop.
Yeah, yeah. When, not that I'm asking you to make their argument for them, but when people try to get this rolled back, what is their reason? What do they say?
Well, a lot of times they call it special... phrasing? When you have enumerated language...
privileges or special...
Special classes? I forgot.
Special privileges.
For others, it had to do with cyberbullying. Mm-hmm. Because... what the law states is that if it is something that starts at school, so it's kids who know each other at school and then goes out or follows them back in, so even though the student might not be on their phone at school bullying the other kid, they're doing it from their bedroom, mm-hmm. that the school is still responsible for that. And so there were people who had issue with that it didn't happen on school grounds, so why is the school responsible for it?
In fairness, though, I can see where that gets tricky.
It is tricky. It's tricky for the schools too.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. Yeah. Wow. Of course, it's cyberbullying is it happens among adults too. It's such a social media so incredibly toxic.
Yeah.
How is that, I mean, because, you both have been at this a while. Has that gotten better? Has that gotten worse? Because my perception, again, now that I'm thinking about it, what I said earlier about how I think it gets better,
mm-hmm.
I suppose if you factor in social media, I'm thinking, well, actually, if you factor in social media, yeah, maybe not. Maybe it doesn't get better. Because it seems like social media, just in general, constantly is becoming more and more toxic.
Yeah.
Social media is easy to hide behind.
Exactly.
Yeah, so the bully can hide behind an avatar, a fake account.
Right.
So there have been instances where you can't track down who's doing the bullying because...
I would think that would happen a lot,
It does. And then, you want to protect the student who's being targeted, but there's no way of discovering who did the bullying.
Well, there's also, I think, something deeper there, too, societally, where with social media, people don't even necessarily feel like they have to hide behind an avatar, because I personally have known people, and I'm sure you both have, too, who on Facebook will behave much more harshly toward others and will say things, will type things that they would never say in person.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
It's strange.
It is strange.
That's one of the reasons, as much as I'm into politics, I don't post anything political on my personal page. The show page I will. But on my personal page, I won't post anything political because I found it so discouraging because people who I know personally who are smart, intellectual people they'll get into a discussion about politics on Facebook and it very rapidly, sometimes almost immediately, devolves into name-calling.
Yeah.
People hurling insults at each other just because they disagree, and it's like, oh, why bother?
Yeah.
I'm sure that with...
They'd probably never, if they were having a conversation over dinner or whatever, they'd keep it respectful.
Right, exactly. Cyberbullying, I would assume, mostly confined to Facebook?
Oh, no.
As far as you know?
No, it's every platform.
Really?
Twitter, YouTube, Tumblr, you name it.
Well, YouTube, yeah.
There are a bunch of lesser-known apps that allow anonymity. So that student, now I can't remember what it was called, but it was a real problem at our school a year or two ago where students were targeting each other and saying mean things on this platform. I cannot remember what it was.
Even the dating apps.
Yeah.
Really?
Catfishing someone.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
It's bad.
Yeah. Yeah, and YouTube, now that you mention it, boy, you ever just read comments under a YouTube video?
Yeah.
It's incredible.
Yeah,
it's
I've had students who were bullied on their YouTube page.
Yeah, yeah. Is there, in terms of, I mean, I assume part of what you do, too, is trying to educate students on how to deal with bullying if they're being bullied. Does that include how students should handle themselves on social media to try to kind of avoid that? Because the interesting thing, too, is we live in a time where everybody, I always say, everyone complains about the lack of privacy, but with social media, it's like our entire culture complains about the lack of privacy at the precise moment that we're giving it away so willingly. So is that part of teaching kids how to deal with it, is how to present themselves on social media?
I don't know that schools are, well, I can't speak for the younger grades, and I don't really know where it starts.
Because you see 10-year-olds now walking around with smartphones on Facebook.
Exactly. So I think it should be a part of the education, because it's just that it's changing so rapidly that it's hard to keep up. And then as a teacher, once you learn, you know, whatever the technology is, the kids have already moved on to something else, and they don't want to hear it, and they know more than we do.
Right, of course.
But I do think it's important, and I think we do have to have a digital citizenship sort of curriculum that's coming up through schools to teach kids how to present themselves and how to treat others.
Mm-hmm.
What
is the policy on phones, cell phones at Concord High?
Well, that is the biggest discipline problem that I face in the classroom. And so we used to have a zero tolerance policy, and that didn't work. And you were supposed to just take the student's phone away and take it to their commons, and parents had to come in and get it. Now that's a last resort. So I have, you know, I've tried a number of things. I have, this was another teacher's idea, but she got an old shoe holder and a charging, a power strip, and so we call it a charging station. So we encourage students to, look, you can charge your phone while you're in class. We now call it the phone spa in my classes, and so I'm just like, your phone, it goes in the spa, or it goes in your bag, or, you know, I'm going to have to take it and take it to your commons, and then it's a big pain because their parents have to come in to get it. So
I like that, the charging station. Yeah. That's good.
So just try to, you know, they get something out of it.
Yeah. I've wondered about that, how that works, you know, because when I was a kid, it wasn't
an issue.
Right. You know, it's funny. I would almost say, I mean, if you could take the social media aspect out of bullying, if people didn't bully on social media, probably no one would have time to bully each other because everyone's walking around with their phones.
With their phone,
But of course, you can cyber bully, so I guess it doesn't. That doesn't work. Now, you had a prom. There was a GLSEN. Is there a prom every year that you put on?
Yeah,
this is going to be our fifth prom this year. We've been doing it for the past 5 years. It's just gotten bigger and better every year.
Yeah.
We've moved into a bigger space. We're at the Puritan here in Manchester.
Yep.
We went from the Pappas Room, and now we're over in the Conference Center. It's great. It's a safe, all-inclusive prom. Mm-hmm. Everyone's welcome. It's wonderful.
Yeah, how many, how many kids did you have there, do you think?
I think we had about 90.
Just about 90.
Wow,
90
really?
Kids.
Yeah. That's
from
great.
All over the state. So we had students who bussed in from Claremont and that part of the state and from up north. And
that's fantastic. And so you had to move to a bigger room.
Yeah.
So are you, obviously you're expecting it to continue to, I mean, has it been growing every year?
It has.
Yes.
Well, the second year it was small. And the problem that year was that New Hampshire's, we always have it on the Sunday before April vacation.
Yeah.
Because it allows us to get a venue for many years we had our proms at the 313 when it was still here in Manchester. And so they donated that, they didn't charge us anything to use the space, and kids just paid like $1 for sodas. That was it. And we mm-hmm. had food donated. But the second, so the big year, the first year was really big. The second year, New Hampshire, for some reason, there were two different vacations. And so there were a lot of kids that just couldn't come. So that year we only had about 30 or 40 youth that made it. But since then we've been steadily growing.
Yeah, good. I almost hate to ask, but do you get any pushback on it, or do you have any protesters or anything?
Luckily,
like that?
No.
Good.
No.
Not yet.
Good.
Yeah, it's not like we've seen in other places.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's been a very safe and positive space for the youth to come to. And yeah, last year they ran a story about us in the Union Leader.
Good. Yeah.
And so that was nice. So yeah, we haven't had pushback. Like in Massachusetts, they have a big prom in the summertime and Youth Pride, and they have groups that show up to protest there. And the kids don't need to see that. People holding up their signs.
No, they actually endanger the kids. When I was in high school when we went, and they took pictures of all the kids and put it up on their website, including myself.
They put Cameron's picture on their website and wouldn't take it down. And I called the police.
I remember you mentioning that when you were here before. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So. Wow.
And he was only 16 years old, and they put a number of my students from Concord High.
No kidding.
Brings up the question of safety for any person who had their picture taken on there.
Right.
Like,
right. Absolutely. Yeah. It's good that doesn't happen here, though. Yeah. That's good to hear.
That's New Hampshire. Live free or die.
Right. Yeah. It's funny because in one sense you would almost think Massachusetts being more liberal.
But
you never know. You never know. Are there states where there's a lot of issues that you know of with these proms where they have a lot of...
I haven't heard from any of the folks that we know of their proms being... picketed or anything like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's more issues with schools, with school proms not letting same-sex couples attend the prom, and they're together and things like that.
Right.
But
what's the policy at Concord High for the other prom?
For the one at our school, I don't think it would be a problem.
I wouldn't guess it would be.
I don't think it would even be an issue.
Well, Concord High had the first transgender person crowned as king.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Wow.
Our homecoming king was transgender.
Wow. That's impressive.
Yeah, and as far as we knew at the time, he was the first transgender homecoming king.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Okay. Very good. Very good. How do people get involved? I mean, where should people go online if they want to learn more about GLSEN?
So they can go to GLSEN.org.
Yeah.
GLSEN. And, .org, and we have that you can go to chapters, and so you can choose New Hampshire if people want to get involved with the New Hampshire chapter, and we have a chapter involvement form on there's a tab get involved, and so folks can fill that out.
You can find us on Facebook, GLSEN New Hampshire. You can send us messages through there. I get all those messages all the time. We have a Twitter, GLSEN NH.
Good.
And an Instagram.
Yes, Instagram. I always forget about Instagram. I need to use that more.
So what's the biggest thing you both have to fight against just in terms of general ignorance? Like we talked about on John's show, the gay conversion therapy, which I love to ridicule because I always think of Marcus Bachman, Michelle Bachman's husband. He's a big purveyor of that, and my theory is he's running away from something.
If it's ever shown, from whatever I've seen, if it's somebody who fights really hard against it, they tend to be part of it secretly. So,
right, exactly, yeah.
You know, it's probably safe to say something like that.
Yeah. God bless them, they've adopted a lot of kids, but they don't have any of their own. That's interesting. I think there might be a reason. But, it's funny because there's people who, like, they'll talk about the gay lifestyle as though it's some sort of choice. And I've always thought that that's so absurd because I've always said, you know, I didn't choose to be straight. You know, I never had a moment during my upbringing where I said, which way do I want to go? Do I want to be attracted to women or men or both? Or seems like all my cool friends, they like girls. So, you know, I want to be one of the cool kids. So I guess, you know, it doesn't work that way. You're just attracted to who you're attracted to. And it's just so, I mean, it's I find it discouraging. I'm sure you both must, that in the year 2017, that there's still people who talk like that, who think that you somehow choose. It's very strange.
Yeah.
But I would guess, Cameron, and I hope I'm right, that with your generation, you probably don't encounter that nearly as much with people your age. Am I right?
Yeah, no, my generation, you don't really encounter that as much.
Yeah, good.
I think the worst I've encountered from my generation is just the misuse of the word, oh, that's so gay. I've had to, you know, stop people right there. No, that's not true. You don't say that.
Right, right.
But yeah, nothing else too serious.
Yeah.
You know, maybe a little bit of the older generation is still a little bit working. I had a conversation with somebody who, in generation two above me, about the whole idea of nature versus nurture.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's one of my biggest things. Like,
I made you gay.
No, it doesn't work like that. Just because you have, you know, a mother who's very loving, and you just have a mother before father comes in, it doesn't work like that.
Right.
No.
Right. Of course.
Can we tell your story about when you first knew you were gay?
Oh, I think I was like 3 or something.
Wow.
Backstreet Boys were, you know, big and popular. I don't know why, as a 3-year-old, I had this dream, but I had a dream that I married one of the Backstreet Boys, and I was on the red carpet. It's one of my earliest memories, but...
Well, okay. I've told you what you already know how I feel, but I'm going to play devil's advocate just for a moment. Is it possible that the Backstreet Boys made you gay?
No,
AJ McLean with his shirt off.
I don't think so because thinking back on it, I don't really remember seeing like music videos of Backstreet Boys on TV very often. It's just, I had their CD, I just listened to their music.
Yeah.
I was a 3 or 4 year old.
Yeah.
I didn't pay attention to that stuff. I was more involved with my Star Wars action figures.
Right.
But,
right.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah. So were you? I mean, not to get too personal, but I mean, I'm sure you've told your personal story a lot with what you do. I mean, were you, like, how soon were you out with it? Or was it something you tried to kind of hide?
Well, I kind of came out at one point in middle school, and then I kind of backtracked a little bit because I was still trying to figure out what was going on. I never thought about it, like, seriously thought about it until 6th grade.
Yeah.
When there was this classmate of mine who was gay openly. And that's kind of when it first popped into my mind, kind of thought about it. I kind of said something to mom when I was, I don't know, 16 maybe? No, way before that. I'm sorry.
You were in 7th grade.
I was in, like, 7th grade when I said something. And then I, you know, went back. I had a girlfriend or two. And then when I was 15, 16, I was like, all right, now I got to come out. I know who I am.
Yeah. And what was your experience like in school when you did that?
It was, for the most part, positive. I didn't face a whole lot of school bullying. But
good.
there was instances of bullying that, you know, people walk by in the hallway and say something. My best friend, Amy, she was probably the best person for me. She would start barking at them like a dog.
Yeah.
Say something completely out there, like, are you stupid? Like, come on. I think, you know, maybe the most serious thing that happened to me, before I got my license, I'd be walking home from school, and somebody threw a water bottle at me as they drove by and, you know, screamed the F word.
Oh,
like,
really? Yeah.
That was the worst that I ever faced, but I, you know, I'm one of the best case scenarios, I'd say.
Sure, oh yeah.
There are people who face, you know, far, far worse.
Oh, yeah.
As we call it, I'm a blue star. We have this activity we do during a lot of our trainings with colored stars, and we go through the coming out process. If you just so happen to have, for example, the blue colored star, you know, you don't rip off any of the points of your star. You have your family, you have your friend, you have your community, your job, your dreams and aspirations, you know, other colored stars, you know, rip off a family member or community, and there's the unfortunate star that loses all of its points, and then it just falls to the ground, and that's the statistic of kids who are bullied who end up, you know, committing suicide and things like that.
Yeah.
So it's
you know, the administration at the school that you were at? Were they aware? Did they get involved? Were they kind of...
Yeah, the administration was really good when I was there. I attempted to start a GSA when I was at the school, but me just being the teenager that I was actually didn't follow through with it.
Yeah.
But I was able to bring my boyfriend to my prom. When we went on the class trip, you know, girls dorm with girls, boys with boys. Yeah. I was not comfortable with that because I had more female friends than I did male friends. So they were like, okay, that's fine. You can go with your female friends. They had no problem with it at all.
Yeah.
Lots of supportive teachers, especially my art teacher. She was probably the best person there for me.
Yeah.
So it was good.
That's really good to hear. Yeah. That's amazing. Wonderful. Well, we have a few minutes left. I mean, what should we know about that we haven't talked about? What is there anything that you both want to express or explain about the organization or about these issues or anything that we haven't gotten into? I mean, I know we've talked about a lot, but I want to make sure that we don't leave anything behind.
I guess if I were to put anything out there is to get involved. The fight's not over.
Yeah.
I mentioned before on John's show, one of my biggest problems, especially with this election and a lot of people getting away with what they're getting away with, is just sweeping it under the rug of, oh, somebody else might take care of it, or I don't want to deal with it now. Like, nothing's going to change unless you get involved and make the change yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's part of the reason why we do what we do. We want to see change, so we're actively doing something about it, and I want to see so many other people do the same thing.
Right. And I always say, too, to people who, we talked earlier about the special classes or special mm-hmm. privileges and whatnot, and I always tell people, it's not that anyone wants special rights. It's just that everyone wants to be able to have the same rights.
Yeah.
Why can't everyone have the same rights? That's what I always tell people about, I was very happy with the Supreme Court decision. I always say I was pro-marriage equality before it was cool to be pro-marriage equality. Even when I was a kid, I was like, why can't gay people get married? What's the matter? But, it's not about giving anyone special rights or privileges. It's just about being able to treat everybody the same. And with that issue, too, a lot of people don't understand that it's like, I like Ron Paul a lot because I have a libertarian streak in me. But he said something once, I think it was when he ran for president in 2004. He didn't understand. He said this during the debate. He didn't understand why gay marriage was even an issue. Because his attitude was, well, marriage is for the church. The civil part is for the government. So as long as you have civil unions, it's a settled issue. And when I heard him say that, it resonated with me. I thought, well, yeah, that kind of makes sense. But then I was talking to a friend of mine who does happen to be gay, my friend Chris, and I told him what I had heard Ron Paul said, and Chris pointed out to me, well, the problem with that is, here's the flaw in that logic. When you go down to City Hall, for example, you don't go to get a civil union license. You go to get a marriage license. The government does not make that distinction, and so unless you allow gay people to have marriage, not just civil unions, but marriage, there's a lot, I mean, we've all either known someone or heard a horror story of, someone's in the hospital and their partner isn't being allowed in to visit them mm-hmm. because, maybe they're married, but not according to the state, by the government's definition or whatever. So, and that's just one example. And you hear about this with insurance and all, there's all kinds of reasons, but it's just a matter of everyone being treated, we're all just people.
Yeah.
In the end, so
there's just nothing special about me. I just want the same rights as everyone else.
Right.
I don't see why anyone else cares.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Well, that's the other thing. It's funny too because you make that comment. Why does anyone else care? That's the other thing I always say to people who oppose marriage equality. It's like, why do you care? Well, it's it affects the sanctity of marriage and whatnot. And it's like, well, you got to be pretty insecure in your marriage if you're worried about everyone else's marriage and what their marriage is. Plus, I mean, the sanctity of marriage, not to be cynical, but, I mean, we live in a country where, what's the divorce rate up
like
to 60% now?
Like 60% or something?
Yeah.
That's what's hurting
we're protecting the sanctity. We have reality shows like Who Wants to Marry a Millionaire?
Yeah.
But we have to protect the sanctity of marriage. It's, come on. And as far as it being, the other thing I say to people, too, and some people get mad at me because they think I'm being flippant, but if you don't like it, you don't have to participate, Like, if you don't like gay marriage, don't get gay married. Marry whoever you want, but, you don't have to like it. There was a time when interracial marriage was illegal. And what's interesting about that, too, is they also say, well, you can't redefine marriage. Well, we already have. there was a time when interracial marriage was illegal, and we redefined it and said, okay, anybody of any race can marry whoever they want, you know. And then so it's we've been redefining marriage since, you know, since the Bible.
Since the beginning.
That's, well, yeah. The version of marriage, you know, heterosexual marriage, it's not necessarily the same version of marriage that was in the Bible, the same book that these people will often use to try to tell you that being gay is bad. It's all very silly to me. So I sorry for the rant, but I get very passionate about this. And I love what you're both doing. And before we wrap up, please, let's make sure, again, I want to make sure everyone knows where to go online to find out information.
Yeah, so glisten.org.
And please spell it.
GLSEN.
Okay.
.org. Go to the chapter section, find New Hampshire. That will be us. Go onto Facebook, Glisten New Hampshire, GLSEN New Hampshire. Send us a message. We get it directly to our phone. Twitter, GlistenNH.
Couldn't you figure out something to do with the other letters to spell the full word? Sorry, I'm a smart ass. I don't know if you figured that out about me. And when this goes up on YouTube, too, people from other parts of the country watch the show online. So that's great. So hopefully people, you know, hopefully you can get to all 50 states.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah, if you're from a different state, look up, see if you have a local chapter. Get involved with them.
Yeah. Or you can get information to start a chapter in your state if there isn't one.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you both so much. Heather Willette Cyan. Did I get it right?
Cygan.
Yeah.
Close.
Not Cyan.
Close.
And Cameron's. Cameron
Willette. Sparky.
Sparky, yes. Cameron Sparky. Well, see, if you ever become a professional wrestler, you've already got a ring name.
Yeah, that's true.
Because Sparky, I mean, that's money right there.
Yeah, it is.
Anyway, all right, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
We will wrap. Oh, and before I go, by the way, if you didn't see Ward 13 with John Hopwood, these two wonderful people also joined John and I for a wide-ranging discussion. We had a lot of fun with that, so be sure to watch that as well. We put both shows up on YouTube the next day. So that's it for now. Thanks, everybody. Talk at y'all a little bit later. Good night.